So we just thank God for you being here today. We're going to read just a few verses over in the first chapter of Acts. First, I want to say thank God we just celebrated the Resurrection Day, that Christ got out of the grave. I don't know when they put him in the grave, but I know one thing, he got up. He got up out of that grave. He said, I'm out of here. Y'all done did what you wanted to do, but I'm out of here. Praise God. You come to the grave, you won't find me in no grave, because I'm out of here. And I let you know that I've left the grave, because when they went in there, they find a napkin somewhere, and their clothes lying just asleep. And they're like, who can do that but Jesus? Nobody. He made his own bed up. It's our picture, so you don't have to do no cleaning up. Praise God. I clean up my own mess, praise God. And just leave it needless, so when you come looking for me, you no more find me in the grave. Praise God. He's not in no grave. But aren't you glad that he got up? If he hadn't have got up, praise God, we couldn't have a chance. When the Spirit of God come into a lost sinner, woman, man, boy, or girl, you're going to see some changes. You're going to see some changes. You will not. You cannot stay the same. When Jesus come in, because he bring about a change. When he come in, he cleaning up the mess out of our lives. Sin, praise God. Forgiving us all of our sin. You say, he don't want to forgive me for this. I did this bad thing. Like a man told me the other day, yesterday, Thursday at the hospital, and they don't expect him to live. But anyway, he said, Mom, I've done so much bad. You don't know what I've done. I said, it doesn't matter. You haven't been as bad as Paul, who was Saul. I said, you haven't been going around persecuting God's people, have you? Binding them and taking them so they'd be put in prison or be killed or whatever. And I said, you haven't done nothing that bad. And no matter what you've done, I better know Jesus Christ still loves you, and his blood is sufficient. He's able to cleanse your heart, make it white as snow, forgive you like he never committed any sin. That's how good our God is. I don't know who wouldn't want to serve him. Who wouldn't want to serve a God that will be there always with you in the midnight hour, wherever you may be, praise God. And things going on in your life, in your heart, praise the Lord, you don't know which way to turn or what to do. You say, nobody understands, but Jesus always understands. I'm so glad, because he was there when I didn't know who to go to, where to turn to. And when I turned to him, he was right there all the time, been there all the time. And he's still with me, in me, never left me, not forsaken me. And I thank the Lord for what he's doing for me right now, for what he's doing for you. So we're going to go to Acts, the first chapter. Read a group of verses. I'll start with the second verse. Until the day in which he was taken up out of the grave. That's what they thought came out of the grave. After that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. to whom also he showed himself alive. In order for him to have shown himself alive, that meant he had died. And he let them know, here I am again. I'm alive. You might have saw me hanging on that cross and then put me in the grave, but here I am alive to spend a little time, 40 days with you, to let you know what I want you to do. To whom he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proof, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. He given them a command what to do, praise God, and if they obeyed, they would get the results that they're supposed to receive. Praise the Lord. So if we expecting God to do something for us, to save us, and to fill us with the Holy Ghost, we have to be obedient. Have to be obedient to receive from the Lord. He said, but wait for the promise of the Father, which said, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. The 8th verse, and ye shall, not might, maybe, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. Praise the Lord. He made a promise there. He let them know you shall. This coming from Jesus' mind. The words of Jesus. He told them ye shall receive power. And if any of you that hasn't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and you've been seeking for the Holy Ghost and you haven't received the Holy Ghost yet, check yourself. The failure is not in God, but it's in you. If you haven't received the Holy Ghost, it's because of something in your life, something you're trying to hold on to. Don't you know God sees in our heart what we're holding on to? God sees every apartment or whatever inside of our heart that we open it up to, letting him come in. But in this apartment, praise God, no way. Stay out of this room here. You might have a room that you get just for you. But if it's just for you to do what you want to do, it's not going to happen. Jesus is not coming in. He's not coming in, praise God. You got to let him clean up the mess, praise God. He's not coming in on no mess. And then it said, and ye shall be witnesses. We can't be effective witness unless we receive the power of the Holy Ghost. Have to have power to be able to witness like the Lord Jesus Christ would have us to witness. Now, if these apostles and different ones had been with Jesus, seeing all the miracles he had performed, all the work that he was doing, giving sight to the blind, raising the dead, the lame, walk, just name it, and they saw the work of God. Now, if he told them that they needed the Holy Ghost, right, don't go nowhere, stay in Jerusalem, don't leave Jerusalem. In other words, he said, I don't want you to do a thing for me until you get some power. Now that goes for us today, because we haven't walked with Jesus like that. We haven't seen no miracle. We didn't see the thing that he did. We read about it, so we believe it. But if he told them, even the mother of Jesus Christ, that carrying him in a womb, if she had to be there to receive the Holy Ghost, well, what about you and I? What about you and I? So we need power today. That is a lot. That's what listening and liking in the church today. So many are trying to live for God without the power of God in their lives. You got to search yourself. And then the scripture let us know we have to cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh. Some of us want to keep on sucking on it. Keep on blowing, keep on turning the bottle up. I'm going to get the Holy Ghost, not like that. Praise God. Someone never received the Holy Ghost that way. You got to make up in your mind you want God more than you want anything in this life. God has to mean more to you than anybody in your life. And that's the only way we can receive from God, when we put Him first. Seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, all these things shall be added unto you. So we need the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. We are living in a crisis-ridden age. The problems of the world are not just economic, political, social, ecological, and educational. They are spiritual. It is high time that we ask the question, what can turn this time? What can turn this moral, bankrupt, and sin-benighted generation back to God? It is high time that we begin to search for the pathway to power, the secret to victory, the dynamite of faith, the more abundant life. Our anemic church needs to be turned to the old past. It is time for the church to awake. Christ is coming soon. Don't know the day or the hour, but He's coming. God's countdown will soon be over. It will soon be over. It is time for us to seek God's face, to hear His voice, and to submit to His will. Are you submitting to His will today? Do you know what He done said for you to do? Are you doing it? Are you going to do it? When you're going to do it? He is still seeking for a man among us to make up the hedge and to stand in the gap. Ezekiel 22 and 30. At that time, in Ezekiel's day, at that time, people were living so immoral, corrupt. Worshiping idols. It was so corrupt. It was just so terrible during that time. And Jesus was looking for a man. If I could just find a man to stand in the gap. And He's still looking for a woman, a man, boy, girl, to stand in the gap. He is seeking for men who can be clothed with His power and speak with His authority. We need men with an authentic touch of heaven to match the time in which we live. Our God is living. He is powerful. He is powerful than any a nuclear weapon bomb. There's nothing no power than God and His power. We must learn how to cooperate with God's moral and spiritual laws. We need men, including women, girls, and boys, who will walk in one direction, not this direction, another direction, but the direction toward God, the way God wants us to walk. Men who will follow one goal, God's will. The world is waiting, and God is waiting for such a man who is willing to pay the price of power, buckle his spiritual armor, and fully follow his great commander into a mighty fight to the finish for the glory of God. There are no shortcuts of spiritual bargain. We are going to have to humble ourselves, pray, and seek God's face, and turn from our wicked ways. 2 Chronicles 7:14. Talking about His people. Not talking about the man out there on the street living in sin. He's talking about us in here. It will take a spiritual awakening to overcome our moral lapse. Amen. A mighty move of the
is what we need above all else. Revival is the only remedy for the disease of spiritual indifference. The Holy Spirit outpouring is the key to blessing. Without this, we stand still and stagnant. We need a new quickening from God today. Nine times the psalmist in Psalm 119 asked God to quicken him. This is what he needed and what he sought. If he needed this, how much more do we today?
Amen.
The great light of our lives is more power. We need more power. More of this Holy Spirit. Feel that we need to stay filled up with the Spirit. The Bible has much to say about power. Power belongs unto God. Psalm 62:11. Paul preached not in word only, but in power and in the Holy Ghost, 1 Thessalonians 1:5. The Lord said, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. In Zechariah 4:6. Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, Luke 4:14. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great was upon them all. Acts 4:33. Like Michael, we must be able to say, but truly I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and of judgment, and of might, to declare unto Jacob his transgression, and to Israel his sin. Micah 3:8. Jesus said, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Acts 1:8. Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Matthew 28:18. Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Luke 24:49. How desperately we need this power today. The Holy Spirit power is the cure for our weaknesses, inadequacy, spiritual fertility, and debilitation. Sin can so easily clip our spiritual wings, immobilize, and inactivate us. There's nothing like sin to throttle, strangle, and paralyze us. Through the Holy Ghost power, we do not need to be sterile, empty, and helpless. God's power is only possible, but it is promised in Acts 2:38-39. We are commanded to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 5:18. We must be linked to God's great dynamo of power. We need the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. He can give us boldness. That's the only way we can have boldness, is when we receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, that power. He give us power to preach his word boldly. Praise God. We don't have to compromise. Praise God. The gospel of Jesus Christ. We can go out and tell the world about Jesus Christ and not be ashamed and not be afraid for our lives. Praise God. When the apostles were filled with the Holy Ghost, they laid their lives on line. because they went about telling everybody about Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, and what he could do for them. Praise God. They weren't worried about being beaten. Right after they received the Holy Ghost and they went about preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, they were beaten so badly. They were thrown in prison, praise God. They were treated all kind of manner of bad ways, but that didn't stop them from preaching about Jesus. That didn't stop them from lifting up the name of Jesus Christ. They were bold as a lion and humble as a lamb. Praise God. You look and see what God did for Saul before his name was changed to Saul. How he was on his way going back and forth to Damascus. God sometimes allowed us to keep on going to the same places, keep on doing the same old sin, keep on talking the same old way, keep on being mean and evil, keep on being hateful, keep on being backbiter. Praise God, keep on dipping or sniffing or whatever. Praise God, drugging, whatever it might be. Alcohol, glory to God. He let you keep on
get it right. If you're gonna be lost, he'll do what street and die, and my soul go to hell. My God, I'd rather put God to take my life. Yes. Again, I looked at him, I said, yes, he's gone. I said, he gone. Go tell him mercy. I did not cry. I did not break down. God Almighty, you remember my faithfulness. He remember me being up late at night. He remember me getting up all day, putting him first. He remember the time me coming down here to every Wednesday morning when the storm was out there. Pastor said nobody was going to have church, but I found my way here. Oh, when we are faithful to God, we don't know when that happens. When we don't know what's going to come upon us that's going to almost blow us away or take all our strength from us. But if you send up them timbers right now, send up them prayers right now, get into the word right now, and allow the word to get in you, praise God. And not only get in them, but obey the word of God. Live up when they say apply, that means live what we reading about, what we studying about. It don't do us no good, the old don't do me no good. The old my God's word and close it and go on like I never read nothing what it said. If we ever needed the Lord, we need him right now. We need him right now. And you know, there are people that don't want you to grow in the Lord. There's people hanging around some of you, so you can't pray like you need to pray. You can't get in the word like you need to get in the word. You can't concentrate like you won't need to. And if you're not careful, no matter how much you think they love you or you love them, but there's time we got to steal away and get along with Jesus. If Jesus Christ had to lead his followers, disciples, and all of them go somewhere and pray, what about me? What about you? Praise God. We're gonna have to spend time along with the Lord. Because when he comes, he's not coming for your friend. When he's coming for me, he's not coming for my daughter, my son. He's coming for me. There's nothing in this world can hold me here when he gets ready to call. Nothing in this world can hold any of you from going when the Lord calls. And it's a sad thing to leave this world and don't know Jesus. Been in the church all our lives for so many years and don't know Jesus. Don't have this, that not filled with the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. He can give us boldness. He can make us witnesses. He can open our ears and eyes. He can loosen our tongue. He can give us love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temper, Galatians 5:22-23. He can give us springs of living water. John 7:37-39. Our lives can be like an artesian well bubbling over with blessings. Don't we want a life bubbling with blessing? God does not want us to live insipid, lives. We can be not only of the Spirit, but filled with the Spirit. Soul winning power is ours for the asking. We must know the deeper life in the Spirit. We must be filled with all the fullness of God. Ephesians 3:19. We can live the crucified life. Galatians 2:20. The imperative need of the hour is for a Spirit-filled Christian. God wants to pour out his power from on high and to deliver us from ourselves and from our sins. The missing element from the lives of many Christians is the power of the Holy Spirit. We can relive the book of Acts
and experience the power of God. We do not have to be spiritually poor or spiritually bankrupt. We do not have to live beneath our privilege. We do not have to wander in spiritual darkness. We do not have to be spiritual lightweights. We can be spiritual giants, full of vigor and vitality. May God give us a new encounter with Himself. The standard of His word are exceedingly high. We can be giants for God, conscious of His power and blessing. The Holy Spirit is the only remedy for the disease of our spiritual paralysis and failure. Too long we have grieved, quenched, and vexed the Holy Spirit. May God give us a new hunger and thirst after righteousness that we may be filled. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification.
What about it?
1 Thessalonians 4:3. For God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. 4:7. The very God of peace sanctify you whole.
Is that supposed to hurt?
And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. 5:23 is all in Galatians. We are to keep His commandments without spot, unrebukable. 1 Timothy 6:14. Again, Paul says, let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. 2 Timothy 2:19. Truly, it is time for us to cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting and holiness in the fear of God. 2 Corinthians 7:1. Call it what you will. That is a call to the higher life, the fuller life, the deeper life, the consecrated life, the victorious life, the spirit-filled life. How desperately we need a fresh visitation from God, a new consciousness of God's presence and power, a new anointing of His Holy Spirit. It is now time for us to cry out as never before. Will Thou not revive us again, that the people may rejoice in Thee? Psalms 85:6. It is time for us to pray, oh Lord, revive Thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known in wrath. Remember mercy. Habakkuk 3:2. Our greatest need is for more God, more of the power of the Holy Spirit, more fasting and prayer. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Isaiah 58:8. May the dawn of this new day soon come upon us. And then shall thy light rise in our security, and thy darkness be at the noonday. And the Lord shall guide thee continually, and satisfy thy soul, and drop, and make fat thy bones. And thou shalt be like a water garden, and like a spring of water, whose water fail not. Isaiah 58:10-11. May God send these blessings upon us, praise God. And if we want the blessing of God to be upon us, we got to obey His word. We got to be not only hearer of the word, but we got to be doer of the word of God. Because that man's out there on the street, people are dying 24/7, 7/24, while you and I are sitting in here, praise God, listening to the word. Somebody just breathe their last breath, praise God. People are dying, young people are killing one another, praise God, being shot down, dying in all kind of ways. But if you know it's all right, if we ready to go, but to die without Jesus Christ, that's the saddest thing that ever could happen, praise God. To die without the Lord in our hearts and lives. Call upon Him while He's near. Right now you got a chance. The blood
bang, praise God. Your heart is yet beating, praise the Lord. You got a chance to say, Jesus, save my soul, forgive me, Lord. Come in my life, I want to change. I want to be made a brand new creature in Christ Jesus. He the only one can do it, praise the Lord. Only God can do it. Look to him for your help. May God bless each and every one of you. Thank you for listening.